One of the things about attending events like this is you get to meet a lot of people with a lot of stories from all around the world. And one such inspiring example here is Marina Muñoz and Carlos Luna. And they are from Generación Tech, but they have an inspiring story to tell about education in Peru and how they're striving to make a difference there with the help of, for example, Raspberry Pi, but they go back before Raspberry Pi. So how did you actually get into education?
Well, I'm a teacher and I studied to be a teacher, but I was very into education. Carlos was very into technology, so one day we decided to, you know, put all together and we decided it was important for us to kids to be prepared in this digital world, you know, to have the digital competencies to be digital citizens. So we knew Raspberry Pi computers. We saw them as a very big opportunity for Peru, as they are like low-cost computers we could bring to Peru and set some labs in rural schools, or, you know, and
kind of our idea was to help close the digital gap.
Yes.
By enable people to have access to technology that otherwise wouldn't have been able to use, and the process learning to use the technology to create something for them, for fun, for giving solutions to some problem, but being able to access technology.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so you became Raspberry Pi resellers eventually, having been inspired by them, and then one of the things that Raspberry Pi does promote around the world is the Raspberry Pi Jam. So you saw that come along, and that must have been like an obvious one for you.
Yeah, actually, we made our first Raspberry Jam before being resellers. We were already working with Raspberry Pi computers and kids, and we got to meet some people using Raspberry Pi, so we decided, why not getting together with everybody who works with this? We need to know each other. We need to know what we're doing or who is working with Raspberry Pi computers.
These things kind of that's why, that's how we get some of the ideas for the things we do. It's like we were on the internet checking things, you know, and it's like, oh, Raspberry Jam, you know about, we should have a Raspberry Pi in Lima, because, you know, our clients, our people, that would be a good way to show everybody what you can do with a Raspberry Pi. Yeah, that would be nice. And it's like you start toying with the idea, and then you get serious about it, and it's like, okay, yeah.
And that was a special year, because that year Raspberry Pi was asking everybody to make an anniversary Raspberry Jam. They were like, become 6 years, 7 years old. The computer was celebrating, I don't remember how many years of being having launched to market.
Yeah.
So at that time, we were like, I don't know, 40, 50 countries celebrating a Raspberry Jam the same weekend. So it was also being part of a bigger community. So it was great. So we decided to make a call for projects, an open one for anyone working with Raspberry Pi projects. We had some lectures on Raspberry Pi, what it is, what can you do with it, and
we gave some of these lectures about the first one. We always call it like Raspberry Pi for Dummies, so you don't know what a Raspberry Pi is. Okay, I can give you some examples, but then we had people who already had some very interesting projects telling the community how they came up with these ideas and how they are using these projects to help people's lives get better.
Yeah.
So you called it Raspberry Pi for Dummies, and the people weren't offended at being called dummies?
No, because dummies means nothing to us except that collection of books that explains you something you don't know.
Yeah.
So, yeah. For us, for dummies means for those who don't know, and that's it.
For novices, in other words. And okay, so you got the jams going, and from speaking to you before, I understand the education system in Peru is very conservative or traditional. Yes. So do you get, is it primarily kids who are inspired to come to the jams with their parents, or do you get some involvement from teachers? And
actually, we got nothing from schools. No parents, no students, no teachers. But that's mainly, that's also because it was in late February.
March. Yeah,
starting first week of March. And we are on vacations. I mean, Peru is on holidays. No one is at school or universities. So it was very difficult to call them to join us to the jam. So what we got in the first jam was a lot of enthusiast people,
students, makers, engineers, makers, yeah.
Makers, engineers, thinkers, all that kinds of people. So we didn't reach our main public, which was, you know, the education field, the teachers, the schools. But we got another community of makers.
The second jam we had, we had some schools, because in the time between the first jam and the second jam, we established some contact with schools. We introduced them to the Raspberry Pi. They used them the whole year with their students, so they had experience, they had projects. We invited them, even though it was difficult for them to organize themselves because they were on vacation. Yeah. They could somehow, they made it, and they had some students showing off what they have been doing during the past year.
The second one was easier for schools to participate. So we have like, and we had like two different, how do you say that, conversatorio, it's, I don't know, two, three people speaking about this.
A round table.
Okay, we had two. One was Raspberry Pi for education. And the other one was Raspberry Pi for... It was for everybody. Because we have a dad with her daughter that they had... They were there, I think, the first and the second jam, or the second and the third. They are always having a project together that was very simple, you know. But the nice thing to see is the interaction on them preparing a project for the Raspberry Jam. And it was great. So second jam was bigger, was better with a lot of people there.
More projects and more people going to see the projects and going to getting into the workshops, eager to know what's this all about. Tell me, can I use this computer? Can I touch? Yes.
Come on. Feel free to touch.
Yeah.
So does the jam always happen at a time when people are on vacation?
Well, not anymore. So we did it 2018, 2019, and 2020. We had the opportunity to do it as it was before everything was closed, and it was the biggest one we had. It was in a school, in an open place, and we had 300 people.
That's interesting, because the third jam was actually in a school. So schools were getting involved into the, you know, organization, into organizing the jam. Yeah.
And we had some sponsors too. We have the Lima Municipality, which is like, it's, I don't know if you use municipality, but
there.
Okay. And then we have schools, universities as part of the organization of all this stuff. So it was big, it was huge, we were happy, everything closed. So next year, 2021, we decided to make it virtual.
Because people were asking for it.
Yeah.
People were like, okay, are we going to have a Raspberry Jam? Let's make it virtual. And we were like, okay, let's make it virtual. And we...
But at that time, we were already resellers. He came to the first resellers event. So we got in touch with Mexico. And we made a Raspberry Jam together, Mexico and Peru, and a virtual, you know, format. It was great. They presented some projects. We presented, I mean, we and Mexico, I don't speak about Generación Tech, but people from Mexico, people from Peru, presenting their projects together, all based on Raspberry Pi. That was amazing. And then, well, we had a second virtual one in 2022.
21.
And this year we decided that, okay, we are going to move the date. We need to look for a date that works for us, Peru. So we made it on July. No, it's August.
August.
And
because the foundation isn't anymore into this thing of encouraging people to get together in the anniversary date. Mm-hmm. It's like you don't have to, you know, do it in the date. Just choose the date that better suits to your calendar, whatever. Okay. So we were like, okay, yeah,
whenever it fits for it, it works for us. So now we just made it like a month ago. It was smaller than the previous ones, you know, 2 years without seeing each other. But people are getting used to, again, it's like, when are we having the other one? We need another one. We want to get together. Sometimes it's like, we tell them, organize one. You don't need us to organize the jam, but they want us to do it. They want us to guide them. I think eventually they will start making their own jams, because we want also to have them in different regions than in the capital. We are in the capital, in Lima, so if they start doing their own jams, I think we can get more communities in different places, you know. But
even though anyone can do it, people look for leadership somehow, and some people just fall into the roles and just you end up de facto leadership of that. But why did you team up with Mexico? I mean, there are lots of other Spanish-speaking countries between Peru and Mexico. How did that happen?
Because at that time, we only met them as Peruvian resellers. I mean, we knew they were Peruvian resellers. They knew us. Also, these people from Mexico, which they are one of the three resellers over there, they are very into, I don't know, TikTok, Instagram, YouTube. They love doing things. So before being myself a reseller, I followed them. I liked them very much. So when we became resellers and we got in touch with them, it was like, you are the one from YouTube. Wow!
She wanted to have her heroes in the program.
So let's get together. Let's do it together. And it worked. Now we know we're more, but at that time we were the two of us only.
Oh, well, so not only leaders, but celebrities now from YouTube as well.
Yeah, we are.
and we like to collaborate, because just as when people come to us and tell us, when are you going to make another jam? And we go like, we don't own raspberry jams. You can do your own raspberry jam. We want people to be able to grow by themselves, you know. We like to collaborate, so for instance, a few hours ago, we had this thing which I can't talk much about with the other resellers, not only from Mexico, but from the other resellers in Latin America and in Spain, because we all speak Spanish, and it was like a good idea. So why don't we sit around a table and have some conversations and chat, and let's see what happens. It's fun collaborating and being with other people.
Yeah. So with you leading it, have you found it's starting to grow organically without you needing to be in other regions in Peru?
We would love to. We need other people to organize them. I mean, maybe universities in other regions. And we can go there. We can help them to be sure. For example, something that it's very important for us is that the projects are projects based on Raspberry Pi. Some people just send the projects when we open this call for projects thing, that they use different hardware that it's not Raspberry Pi. So it's, I mean, good for you, but it's not for the Raspberry Jam. Mm-hmm. So what we are telling these people who wants to make jams, or we are encouraging them to make jams in other regions, is that we can help you checking the projects. We can help you, you know, having this lecture with this the dummy thing and all that stuff. But you can have your own project. You can call people to make projects locally in your region, because we want to see what you are doing. It's not that you want to see what we are doing, but we want to see what you are doing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I suppose they need some sort of tutorial, and YouTube can help with that.
Yeah.
But are you finding that you're making a difference where the younger generation, the kids, are not seeing a piece of technology as a magic black box, but something they can actually make themselves and control and get it to do what they want?
Yeah,
I hope so.
You know, last time we had this jam in the school, I think there was this guy. He just finished school, And he showed us his project. He had this backpack computer he had made for when he was in school, because he wanted to have access to his computer, but of course he couldn't have access to it while in classes. So he kind of like cheated. He built this computer into his backpack, and he had this, you know, like what you use around your waist.
Funny pass.
Yeah. Yeah, and he had installed a wireless screen to that. So every time he wanted to watch what's going on in his computer, he would go like this. And he was in, or he would go like, can I go to the bathroom? And he would carry his backpack. Was his computer? It was so so well made.
Yeah.
The cabling and everything was so engineered. It was amazing, and he was, a teenager. He was a teenager. So when you see that kind of commitment, because he wasn't doing this for homework. On the contrary, he was doing it because it was not homework, and it would help him get away from homework.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, I think. I don't know if it's us, it's the Raspberry Pi, or it's a combination, but I think we are getting some people inspired, and yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's great. We need more of that in the world, especially where I'm from, South Africa. We could do a lot with people like you. Maybe we should fly you out there and you can help us as well, as if you don't have enough on your hands.
Well, we can
manage it. Yeah, right.
At a couple of hours into the day, you know, or sleep even less. Because sleep is for mortals.
Well, thanks so much for the time, for sharing your story with us. I thought it was very inspiring. So hopefully this can get more organic and spread out to more of the world, not just Peru.
Thank you for the opportunity. We are more than happy to share what we do. We are more than happy to share what we have learned. I think it's part of what we do. We need to share. We need to grow together. That's the only way to grow. So thank you very much.
Okay, great. Thank you, Marina, and thank you, Carlos.
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity, and I hope we go viral. Yeah.
And as always, stay tuned for more inspired stories like these at Elektor TV.